This module represents research work done at the University of Florida with an attempt to study ways in which we may model in the near future. It does not represent the sole future of dynamic modeling by any means, but it represents one of many ways in which modeling can be strengthened as a discipline to allow us to improve the modeling process by changing the way in which we craft model components and structures. This talk will proceed as follows. We'll start with an introduction, talk about some things from the past, back to the future, describe our current research, give you examples of virtual and physical models, and then follow up with a new area that has the potential to change the way that you look at models in terms of their components and structures. Begin with an introduction. Every piece of research has to start out with a problem statement. Our problem statement, in its most basic form, is that mathematical structures can be hard to understand, implement, and use. And by mathematical structure, we mean things that are built upon mathematical structures, such as computer programs as well, knowledge formalisms, and data formalisms. Our specific focus in this talk will be dynamic model structures that are used for simulation. One solution is to make modeling personal and customized by enhancing individual and group usability and separating content from presentation. That is, content being the specification of the model versus presentation, which is the way that the human interacts with it, the way it looks, the way it sounds, the way it feels, the way perhaps it even smells, using all the human senses. Also, we need to make modeling immersive and engaging, creating 3D virtual, physical, and augmented environments for dynamic models. One way to achieve this is to recognize a new area which we'll call human model interaction. To describe this, we first need to look at a hierarchy. Here's the human interacting with the computer, and then we have a model, and the model separates the human from the hardware. So we have human, model, and computer, which is the hardware. And our work is at different levels depending on where it falls within this particular chain. So at the top, you look at particular hardware interfaces that achieve an augmented reality capability, which is multimodal by nature, combining virtual and physical ways in which to connect to the model. There's the presentation, in which we have tended to use the X3D standard, or extensible 3D. This is a follow-on to the VRML standard as the next generation standard for 3D on the web. Then there's the extensible markup language, which from our perspective we can think of as a kind of extensible modeling language. But markup can also encompass different sorts of media. And at the bottom level we have software, and for software we're using a toolkit which we've created called SimpacJS, which is a set of tools for simulation for doing discrete event simulation specifically in Java and JavaScript. Contributions of HMI, why is it important? Well, certainly it promotes interchange, model content, model presentation. One can create prototypes, new modeling interfaces, as an educational benefit in that it enhances communication, training, and management. And it serves as a bridge between different cultures, whether they be native or artificial cultures, aesthetics, and mathematical modeling. Some of the prior research that we've done is in creating toolkits to support discrete event and continuous time simulation. They include SimPack, which was created in 1990, and OOSim, or object-oriented simulation, in 1995. These are C and C++, respectively, based simulation support libraries. And they support discrete event as well as continuous modes of simulation. Then we created, after SimPec, we created Moose, Multi-Modeling Object-Oriented Simulation Environment, later changing that name to OOPM, or Object-Oriented Physical Modeler. This is in the 96 to 98 time period. And OOPM sported a visual 2D TCL-TK interface. So it was a graphical user interface and allowed models to be created in 2D on the computer screen. Our most recent work started with Rube and continues with the Rube project today. And for phase one, it began with Vermal protos. In the past, we use a technique called the prototype node within the Vermal scene graph in order to represent that extra information that's required to designate model components as state, events, functions, and other attributes that are important for simulation. Now, here's an example of, for instance, an OPM finite state machine window. You have a window that pops up, and this modeler would allow you to create states and transitional arcs between states, and then to label these transitional arcs with Boolean values involving input and internal state variables that are located within these states. And so this represents the dynamics of the apple snail. Here's another piece of dynamics for the apple snail, but using the SD modeler in OOPM. This allows one to create a system dynamics model where we have valves, which represent rates, and we have levels and boxes and constants, and other things associated with the system dynamics formalism. The Vermal protos look something like this. You have a proto statement or an extern proto. And this is one that represents the finite state machine state construct. And inside you have various attributes or fields within Vermal that allow us to encode the concept of state. And so this is what prototype nodes allow you to do in Vermal. They extend their extensibility mechanism within Vermal itself to allow you to build application-specific, in our case, model and simulation-specific information. And then we have script nodes and routes. And by using script nodes and routes, we're able to achieve simulation using Vermal. Now let's go back a little bit into the past. And in doing so, we'll see how things in the past, namely the evolution of languages, have affected modeling structures and the way we view them today. Probably the best way to do it is just to see how do we look at models today. One way is we look at models is we see them in books. We see them in flat media. Even the flat media that you see on your computer screen is the evolution from the book, which is where you see model types. And so we're quite used to looking at models in that fashion. However, if we fast forward into the future, into the land of Star Trek. Star Trek had something called a holodeck, and in the holodeck, which was located in part of the Enterprise Starcraft, you would have the ability to create any object and any program that would program an artificial world with any number of artificial objects. So what it basically gives you is a kind of a virtual reality the best way you can think of virtual reality is that you step into the holodeck when it's been programmed, and it doesn't look like this. Instead, it looks like something that you might see inside or outside, or you might be very familiar with, except that it'd be completely digital. And so we have to ask ourselves with modeling is, what if we could create models using the holodeck? What would they look like? Now, realizing that we don't have this technology today, but also realizing that the state of our technology advancement is moving us gradually in this direction. So we'd like to move away from flat material, or at least to augment the flat material with other kinds of models that are suggested by science fiction shows such as Star Trek and the holodeck that you find on the Enterprise. What are the supporting trends for this kind of thought? From the past, we should note the following, that model presentations today are largely dictated by economies of labor and materials, but also that economies are rapidly evolving. So let's go over this for a second. The way that you present or notate models or mathematical structures today is largely dictated by the cost of materials and the amount of time that it takes you to produce these notations. This is why you see flecks of ink on cotton. Not because flecks of ink on cotton are necessarily an ideal way to model, but because they're cheap and they have evolved into a type of economy that has happened to work well for us. From the present, we can see XML technologies that support separation of content from presentation. This is really quite a remarkable capability that the extensible markup language gives us, is that you can have a mathematical expression in MathML or a dynamic model in one of the modeling languages that we'll talk about shortly, and that the presentation of this model is logically separated from this content specification. XML technologies give you style capabilities so that you can take separate things called style sheets, apply them to the same content to achieve personalized and customized presentations of the models. So this suggests a convergence to the Star Trek ideal or Nirvana, is that we are actually moving in that direction. Also, when we look at XML, we look to the future, we see that 3D tangible and ubiquitous interfaces are becoming faster and cheaper. We see journals and magazines devoted to tangible computing, ubiquitous computing, mobile computing, and 3D is becoming faster and cheaper on today's hardware. So this all suggests a movement in the direction of the holodeck, even though it may take us many decades in order to get to something that remotely resembles the Star Trek holodeck. Let's go a look in the past. What's interesting is to note that language and mathematics derived from the same source. Tokens in Babylonia represented amounts of grain, oil, and other commodities that it was necessary to keep track of. So there was an accounting, a need for accounting back then, and they created these little clay tokens which were fired and hardened, and then certain etchings were made in order to make them singular and identifiable. These tokens were eventually put in an envelope. And even though this doesn't look necessarily like an envelope, it is. It's a place where tokens are placed. And something amazing happened where tokens were placed in the envelope, and they were put in the envelopes as a kind of contractual artifact so that one person could have a contract with another for selling commodities that these tokens represented. And again, oil, sheep, grain, and so forth. So the envelope contains the little tokens, and then one day, over really quite a long period of time, someone thought of the idea of, gee, maybe instead of having to break or crack the envelope in order to obtain these tokens, they could produce etchings on the outside of the envelope itself so that the tokens didn't have to always be removed and the envelope broken. And then they thought, well, why do we need the tokens? Because we've already got the outside of the envelope where the scratches are made that represent the tokens on the inside. So originally these marks in cuneiform were representations for what tokens existed on the inside of the envelope, and they gradually evolved into their own language. So this is how mathematics and language evolved. If we take a look at the stylization of Chinese, we see an interesting evolution. For instance, we can take a look at some ancient Chinese character representations, or iconic representations, as they started out, for elements such as the sun and the moon, mountains, bird, and water or river. Now, these things can, even if you don't know Chinese, you can certainly note these and imagine what these signs represent. But as we move forward in time, from ancient times to modern times, look at the stylistic change. We get a change in the sun from looking like something that looks like the sun. It has an iconic relationship to the sun, to something that looks like this, which is the modern character, Chinese character for sun. And these animated pictures over here show you three examples. Sun, the evolution of characters that move towards the modern sun. Mouth, and woman. Now, one thing to note in this and the previous slide is that most of this stylization was done for reasons of efficiency. We get back to the idea that notation chiefly is a result of that which is efficient. So it turned out to be inefficient, especially in terms of the number of strokes required, the ability required, or the machinery required in order to stamp out these forms was less complicated with these forms on the right than with these forms on the left. And the same thing is said from the previous slide here, is that the reason for moving from the tokens to the cuneiform on the outside of the envelope and then dispensing with the idea of envelope entirely is mainly as a result of the expense in creating these and presenting them. Now let's also consider some present day concepts from filmmaking and games. If we take a look at games, this is a snapshot of Return to Castle Wolfenstein. And just from the snapshot, it's one of many new games, computer games that come out, but you see the realism involved with this. And if you're even going to get more realism, then you go to the movies and you may see Final Fantasy and many other special effects that show you even more that what can be done with computer games today. So this is completely digital human and digital hair. And over here we have completely digital textures, buildings, trees, and avatars or people or gamers that are moving around in this space. Now what this suggests is as follows. These spaces currently are used for iconic purposes. That is, they're used to represent things that have an iconic relationship to them. For instance, this thing represents a tree. This thing represents a building. This thing represents a human. This thing represents real hair. So these are iconic relationships of these signs. However, these signs are now becoming affordable to the extent that we may create symbols from them. So these buildings need not represent real buildings. We may build structures like this to represent concepts and information, or program structures, or mathematical structures. These structures have not been created in this fashion before, not for lack of interest. They haven't been created like this before, primarily because of the expense needed in order to create this kind of illusion. Current research. Our current research involves an area which I'll define in a moment later on, titled Aesthetic Computing. And the purpose behind this is to reintroduce aesthetics, which leads us into customization and personalization of the model, into representations. We create an experimental methodology and software framework called Rube. And we have two types of XML languages called Dynamics Exchange Language and the Multi-Modeling Exchange Language. Let's relook at what models are. Let's consider models as not static entities that are ink blots embedded within cotton, or excited phosphorus elements that allow you to see it on your computer screen. Let's imagine that models are productions where you need to choose a space, choose an architecture, landscape, buildings, choose actors to move around on this space, or agents, if you will. And these would be people and props. We enable engagement and immersion through making things 3D and having the right hardware interfaces. And we use virtual or tangible technologies. Now let's go ahead and look at the Rube framework. Rube looks like this. This is the kind of a two-dimensional architecture for Rube. What we do is we start out with Rube. We start out with a scene file and a model file. The model file is the content for the model. The scene file is the presentation for the model. Our focus is using X3D to represent dynamic model components. So X3D without the program, without any pieces of Java or JavaScript, is located here. MXL is our multi-modeling exchange language, and that represents the content. So MXL might represent the content for a system dynamics model, an equational model, a finite state machine, a Markov model, and so forth. Using a translation mechanism called XSLT for extensible stylesheet translation, we automatically can create DXL from MXL. A DXL can be thought of as a kind of model assembly layer, which is composed of all of the same type of block. You've got blocks, you've got ports, and you've got connectors. And that's pretty much all you have in DXL. Whereas in MXL, it's more heterogeneous, and you can use XML-based syntax to capture the semantics or the connections and topology of models such as the ones we just talked about, system dynamics models, finite state machines and equations, and so on. So whereas things appear differently here, they appear to be all the same in terms of blocks, JavaScript, Java, and connectors and ports down at the DXL level. Ultimately, you've got a program in either Java or JavaScript. And this program is built with the assistance of SimpacJS, which is a library used in order to help create the program. So using SimpacJS and especially the program that's created from translation to DXL from MXL. We take our model, and our model is translated down into Java or JavaScript. So here we have X3D without a program. Here we have a program. These two things are combined together in what we'll call model fusion down here. And in model fusion, we create X3D with a program, and that allows for an interactive executable environment in X3D. Rube files look like this. Here's an example of a Vermal scene file. And the X3D scene file looks very similar to Vermal, except that it's in an XML-based syntax. So what we'd be saying here is that, okay, we've got three states. We've got a finite state machine, but what we're going to do is we're going to create some spheres and some cylinders and cones, and these are how we're going to present the finite state machine with spheres, cylinders, and cones. So this is what we're doing on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, the finite state machine itself has to be defined, and that's defined using the language MXL. And we can see that we've got S1, S2, S3 for three states and three transitions. Let's look at a sample system. We've got a light bulb. Light bulb can turn on, light bulb can turn off in response to a pull chain. How will we model this system? Well, there are different ways in which we can create models for the system. We'll say that the real-world light bulb that has a dynamic capability of being able to turn on and off has a scale model that looks like this, but we're also going to use a finite state machine in order to create content for the dynamic model. So here's the real world light bulb. We have a dynamic model over here. We've got a scale model over here. This entire structure can be considered a concept graph or a semantic network or a knowledge graph or whatever kind of term that you might want to use. For finite state machine, even though we have one content file in MXL, we can have many different types of presentations. We can look at it textually with Greek and Latin letters, and this is what is typically used for presenting mathematics and mathematical models. Or we can look at circles and arcs in a 2D diagram, or we can use spheres and pipes, as we suggested on the last slide. Or we can use different sorts of metaphors, and we'll show some example movies of these in a while, where we can have tanks and fluid flow that represent the change from one state to another, or a person moving from one gazebo or structure or hut to another, where the huts and gazebos represent states. Now let's show some virtual models, which give an idea for what we can do with Rube and its architecture. Definition of a virtual model would be a digital or 3D mathematical structure. And the purposes are interactive mathematical structures, aesthetic customized presentations, and the virtual model serving as a sample future modeling interface. Technologies that we tend to use can be Flash, SVG, Vermal, and X3D. SVG is a term, an acronym we haven't talked about before. This is Scalable Vector Graphics, which has been pushed a lot by Adobe Corporation and is a worldwide web standard for 2D, Whereas X3D is becoming the standard for the web for 3D. And what we'll do is we'll just show some pictures of some virtual models that we've created. This is a finite state machine. The finite state machine is presented as a set of Greek columnar types of structures, almost like Parthenon structures, where you've got a Parthenon-like room for each state. So here's a Parthenon room, number one, number two, number three, and then there's a little avatar, which is right here, and this avatar moves from one room to another, representing a change in state from one state to another. The dynamics for this finite state machine right here capture the dynamics of the Cassini probe that lands on Saturn's moon Titan. And so while it has somewhat of an exotic application, the actual dynamic model structure itself is fairly simple here. It's just a three-state finite state machine that is fairly linear in structure, one state to the next, state one, state two, and state three. This is a snapshot of the dining philosopher's Petri net in three dimensions. And you can see the metaphor. It's almost a projective third dimension metaphor or translation from the two-dimensional structure. So you see, instead of circles for places, you have spheres. And instead of rectangles for transitions, you've got cubes. And then you've got lines which connect places to transitions. This is an operating system. And the operating system shows CPU and then various resources for the CPU, device, communications, memory, and I.O. And the metaphor here is kind of an office metaphor where you've got agents that move around, where the agents are jobs. The jobs need CPU and then need a device and then or resource, and then they move back to get the CPU. So the job is basically go to the CPU, go to one of these four resources, head back in here, and then back into the CPU. And they continue this process until they're finished. So this is a modeling structure for an operating system. And here's a close-up of a job receiving service from the CPU. Now, there's a couple things that may come into mind when you see something like this. We're so used to two-dimensional and mathematically oriented models that we may say, well, this is fine for presenting it to management, but we really want to model it in terms of Greek letters and Latin letters. But we have to look at this in a different way. If it becomes cheap enough and effective enough in order to use 3D and to use metaphors, then we should consider actually using this for the model itself and not seeing this as some sort of exotic presentation or a form of entertainment for novices. But it certainly can serve in that fashion. So there's a kind of a cultural divide or cultural evolution I think we need to go through in order to be able to consider these sorts of metaphor-based structures as the actual model themselves and not as novice-based visualizations of the real models, which are flecks of ink on cotton. This is a working architecture for the Itanium Intel chip in three dimensions. And what we're going to look at here is we're going to look at three different presentations for exactly the same finite state machine. This presentation is going to be the working finite state machine model that uses a kind of Platonic-based metaphor or style where you've got spheres and cylinders. And over here, we're going to have a model that is exactly the same except using a fluid metaphor. So you see that here's state one in this model. Here's state one over here. Here's state two, and here's state two. In here, we're going to have a woman that moves from one gazebo to the next, with each gazebo or hut structure representing the states. So we'll go ahead and turn each of these on so that we can see these models in operation. Now, one thing to note with these is that these models move. That is, there are dynamics. I'll go ahead and turn these on again. They're very active. Here we have a state where you've got a brightened node. Here we've got fluid flow that moves from one tank to the next. And here we have a moving person or an avatar. So it's not only that these represent models of some real world process, like the turning on and off of the light bulb or the apple snail or whatever that you might consider. It's that the models themselves are dynamic. So the models are dynamic and in 3D, and they represent dynamic target systems which are in 3D. And this is very similar to the traditional method of modeling, where you use three-dimensional physical structures to model ships, toy boats, and so forth. Let's look at some other examples. We'll do these one at a time because these are a little bit more complex models. This is Newell's teapot. Newell's teapot is used in computer graphics and has a kind of an iconic importance because it's been used as an icon for SIGGRAPH itself. And what we have is we've got Newell's teapot itself in three dimensions over here with water. And then we've got a dynamic model right here with three functions and a finite state machine here that represent the dynamics of boiling water in terms of a multi-model for Newell's teapot. We can see the temperature changes as you press the knob here. Then the temperature changes in the water over here, and the dynamic model also changes as it goes through its operations in real time. Okay, now let's focus over here. This is the Cassini model, and this is where you have a finite state machine model representing the dynamics of the Titan probe. In a moment, we see an overview of the finite state machine in operation. And so this just gives a sort of a different moving picture. It gives you a kind of different perspective on this finite state machine. Now, lastly, we have a dining philosopher's model. And this dining philosopher's model involves a person saying which philosopher is eating at any one time. You've got philosophers 1 and 3 eating, 2 and 4 eating, and so forth. And you can see change in color, representing which philosopher is in control of the chopsticks. And you also get this audible message in the model. So the model is certainly very engaging and immersive. And the person that created it decided on how they were going to represent places and transitions. So it's a customized structure. This is a model of a traffic light, and above here you have a finite state machine which happens to be sitting on the thing that it's modeling. The thing that it's modeling is a traffic light. This traffic light is seen as we back away from the system, as we're doing now, and we see the individual traffic below. So we do, in this system, have the thing that's being modeled, namely the traffic, and the thing that is doing the modeling, which is the finite state machine, in the same system. And over here, we've got someone who preferred to look at finite state machines in terms of gears. And this is a kind of a gear metaphor then for moving from state 1 to state 3 and allowing this mechanism to represent our finite state machine. This is an example of a virtual plotter. This virtual plotter plots out the spiral of Cornu and the mathematical equation that when executed creates the spiral is inside the plotter itself. And so you open the plotter up by just making it transparent. And then the mathematical equation with integrals and with multipliers and so forth are located, are presented in 3D elements that are inside the plotter. There's a visual cue right here representing the size of the sine value and the cosine value as the height of a kind of a liquid that's in this tank. And this just shows you the spiral of Cornu that is actually being created in 3D. On the back here, we have a blackboard. On this blackboard, there's a two-dimensional representation of the X and Y parts that build and make up the spiral of Cornu. And you can see that right here in this snapshot. This is actually created over time and shown on the blackboard back here. So we have a combination of things. We've got the phenomenon being modeled, and we have the model, and they're all within exactly the same immersive three-dimensional space. This is, on the right, somewhat of a humorous model for the human life cycle in a Petri net, which is done in 3D. So we start out with fertilization and go through various stages, all modeled with a Petri net. And we just let this go ahead and go through its workings. This was created by one of several students that I've had in the simulation class. So this comes to an end here. And again, I want you to put on your thinking cap and imagine that this isn't only a tool for teaching and for communicating, especially to novices or management, but as these 3D worlds get easier to create, we can use these to augment and possibly even substitute for our traditional 2D models. Now, some of the physical models are literally physical pieces, and I've had students build some of these models to represent some model structures. So the definition of this is a physically manifested mathematical structure. What purposes does this have? Well, certainly building this physical model is educational. It's a very engaging model. It's 3D. People can touch it. It can also be seen as an art piece on display. But in the sense of tangible computing, it can be viewed as a sample future modeling interfaces. So this rapid prototyping becomes efficient, and it becomes easier to move physical pieces around and have sensory capabilities with computer vision, cameras, ultrasound, and perhaps magnetic approaches in order to detect the physical piece itself, where it's located, and where its position, its orientation, and so forth. As this becomes easier, then we may build more of our models with physical material. Now, technologies that students have used in the past includes various forms of physical multimedia: wood, plastic, metal, glass, cardboard. Here's an example of a finite state machine that is the boiling water multimodel using plexiglass and wood. And here we've got wooden states with corridors representing the transitions. And this is a close-up of the physical model. Now, some of these models were recently on display at the University of Florida in a gallery, and these represented the best models for a class in aesthetic computing taught this last spring. This is a finite state machine for a pond ecosystem. It was constructed by someone who's an architect, and the metaphor that they happened to choose was kind of a modernistic based one, and you've got individual states representing with this plywood, and the transitions are these little plexiglass planes. This was an entity relationship model, a kind of model very familiar to those of you who work with databases. And a model, it's an ER model then, where ER does not happen to stand for emergency room, but entity relation of a healthcare center. This is a finite state machine using a metaphor of a room with some pictures on the walls for cues, memory cues, and orientation cues, and then doorways representing transitions between states. This is a close-up. Aesthetic computing. Well, the definition of aesthetic computing will be the study of artistic personalized mathematical structures. We have undergraduate and graduates together in the spring in aesthetic computer courses at the university. And this is integrated with the Digital Arts and Science curricula and the Digital Worlds Institute at the University of Florida. We have a news group on Yahoo. And in July 2002, there is a workshop in Germany in Dachstuhl, and this will be on aesthetic computing. And in it, there will be participants from computer science, media theory, and art. Some of these structures that we've been talking about, talked about the virtual 3D structures and the physical structures, which almost look like architectural models that people tote around on campus. In order to create these structures, it's advantageous to have an individual, a student, that has a good knowledge of art, but also good knowledge of engineering and mathematics at the same time. So over the last few years, we've developed a curriculum, Digital Arts and Science. And we have an undergraduate curriculum and a graduate curriculum that I'll describe here. The Digital Arts and Science student has general education credits. They also take all the engineering mathematics requirements, same requirements as for the computer engineer. They have basic science, physics, and chemistry. They have the same computer science core that our computer scientists take. But that's where it deviates from the traditional computer engineering or computer information science degree. There is a pre-DAS art core at the kind of lower levels. And then there's a production studio. And the production studio is where students from art and engineering get together. And they get together in the same studio class to do teamwork in order to create productions. These productions are chiefly virtual or digital in nature. They could be films, they could be Vermal worlds or X3D worlds, and so forth. So, was ist das? Okay, das, Digital Arts and Science, is a set of two programs. One in fine arts, where the students can get a BA, MA. In CISE or computer science, they can get a BS or MS, and then students come together in the production studio classes. Now let's take a look at the MS curriculum. At the master's level, we have required classes in computer graphics and simulation, and then we have electives that are related to digital arts and science topics. We have vision, computer vision, artificial intelligence, visual modeling, and aesthetic computing, for example. the student is required to do a master's thesis, and they also, these graduate students are also in the production studio. And the production studio, in the production studio classes, the graduate students serve as leaders or directors or producers for the undergraduate students. What I want to show you now is are three videos from the class Aesthetic Computing. And the first one is a Barnsley Iterated Function System. I'll let the student talk about this. The second is a representation of the law of gravity. And the third is an information or data-based structure, an entity relationship model. The first system right here that we'll be talking about and showing a movie on involves a student, Christian Damker, who will explain it. These next two pieces involve media that are owned by their respective authors, artists. The first one is owned by Joella Waltz, called The Law of Gravity. And the second one is authored and owned by Reedy Sampira.
Okay. My name is Christian Damker, and this model is the Barnsley Conservatory. The basic idea of this model was to map an iterated function system, which is a type of fractal geometry. The basic idea that I have are that there's various levels of abstraction here, the finest granularity being going all the way down to determining sine and cosine values for a specific angle. The next level up would be then determining various transformation matrices and how they combine together to produce a single transformation matrix for an entire group of information. These then can be further abstracted to these sets of transformation matrices, which result in a single value, transformation matrix being produced for each group, which then is iteratively processed by means of a random number generator, which is mapped to this fountain, and a distribution, a probability distribution, which is mapped to these various channels here. These each have triggers on them, which map to a multiplexer, which selects one of these as input to be combined with your current state. And as this processes iteratively, this cannon fires a point it to be mapped into this three-dimensional space, which iteratively produces the attractor, which in this case is the Barnsley Fern. These attractors can be two-dimensional or three-dimensional, I guess that's about it.
Okay, great.